Greeting in the wonderful name of our Lord and Savior, Jesus Christ. Amen. Amen. Please start with a word of prayer. Let me pray for us. Father, we pray that you will give us a renewed commitment to walk with you, to walk in obedience, to be faithful, to love you with all our hearts, with all our soul, with all our minds and strength, to love one another, Lord, as we have been singing, that we are one in you, to be servants in every sense, slave of Christ. We pray, Lord, that since you are the one who have drawn us to yourself, may you help us to be prepared to hear you, to trust you, to delight in you, and to delight in your word. Speak to us, O Lord, through your word this evening, to your glory. In Jesus' name we pray. Amen. As many of you have observed that many Christians, even in this last couple of weeks and month, and even in the next couple of weeks and month, they've been protests against the president. And so many Christians have been involved in such protests, some being against the president, and others maybe for the president. Then a friend of mine asked a question: when then we get to the church, do we then pretend to each other? I guess he thought about the unity of the church. He thought that the unity of the church is at stake due to this protest. Not that I agree with him, but I can understand the concern, because unity is the vital component of God's building his church. And it is our goal at this church that the Lord may use us to build his own church. Every true church, no matter where you are, no matter where it is, its desire should want to have unity. But not every church knows how to get that. How can a church be united? Drinking coffee together is good. Talking to each other before and after the service is good. Having a church picnic or a braai is good. Those things help us to get to know each other. But so many often, as we get to know each other, we tend to gather the like-minded. We tend to have a circle of these are the like-minded. We tend to get to know each other and ended up being isolated group of Red Bee lovers, an isolated group of homeschoolers, an isolated group of Indians or whites or colors or blacks. As we get to know each other, we get to decide, I can be in this circle, and we close our own circles. Definitely, these things can help us to know each other better. But clearly, these things don't create a true unity of the church. They are good in themselves, but I guess something deeper needs to be done. Let's hear from the counsel of God as we read from the book of Ephesians. Please turn with me your Bibles or devices to the book of Ephesians chapter 4. Ephesians chapter 4, reading from verse 1 to verse 6. I, therefore, a prisoner of the Lord, urge you to walk in a manner worthy of the calling of to which you have been called, with all humility and gentleness, with patience, bearing with one another in love, eager to maintain the unity of the Spirit in the bond of peace. There is one body, and one spirit, just as you were called to the one hope that belongs to your call. One Lord, one faith, one baptism, one God, and the Father of all, who is over all and through all and in all. So basically, the text is about this opening verses is about the walk in unity. Paul exhorts his readers to walk worthy of the calling of salvation. So in this, we will look at the three essential truths of how that looks like in a Christian life. The opening verse says, I therefore, the prisoner for the Lord. I therefore, just a bit of a background. When you see therefore, you ask a question, why is therefore for? So it's here because it's connecting what has been said to what is now going to be communicated. So this book has six chapters, and I know you know this. The pastor has gone through the book of Ephesians already. So the first three chapters basically it's about the doctrine, and the last three chapters from chapter 4, 5, and 6 about the practice. So the first three chapters, God is saying, I have made you Christians. And from chapter 4 is an exhortation that now live like one. You have been made Christian by God, and he explained that this is a gift of God. Our redemption in him is a gift of God, and explained that we have been blessed with so many spiritual gifts in chapter 1. And now he said, now since we have been in this position that we are Christians, now we need to walk like one. Now we need to show that we are Christians. This is the calling he's talking about, the calling of salvation. So the exhortation here is that we need to walk in a manner worthy. I'm using this verse. It's a key verse, actually, to the rest of these chapters. That we are now, since now, it's not that we are working towards our salvation, but since we have been saved by the grace of God, now out of our love for God, we need to serve him in this way. And the first thing that he's talking about is the walk in unity. So this verse 1, while we're talking about this theme of walking in unity, verse 1 is an opening verse calling us to walk in a manner worthy. And in these six verses, I will use this to say we are required, we are called to walk in unity. And the next two verses, verse 2 and 3, we will see how that looks like in practice. And then the last two verses, 4 to 6, we'll see the cause of our walk in unity. Why is it necessary? Why is it a command to us to walk in this manner? A call for Christians is that we need to walk in a way that when our walk is being put to the scale, it will weigh as much as we have the knowledge in Christ. That's a worthy walk. A worthy walk simply means when we weigh how you walk in comparison to the knowledge you have in Christ, do they match? We are called to walk, to conduct ourselves, to live in a way that when we, God look at us, can see, yes, the manner in which you walk represents the knowledge you have that is being revealed in the scriptures according to God. We are to be those who are willing to live in a way that pleases the Lord. We are to be those who care about how do we conduct ourselves. Do you want to do what God says? Do you care about what God says? Are you trying to honor him with your life? Any true Christian, of course, will say yes. Or are we those of us who preach love but practice hatred? Those who speak of sexual immorality but defile ourselves? Are we those who proclaim unity but are divided into countless factions? Or are we those that makes the church of God to look bad? Atheists and unbelievers look at us and say, like, what you believe is so awesome, but the way you walk is so disgusting. Atheists having to confess that actually, if every Christian can walk as much as they preach, they will change the whole nation. It's a call, it's an exhortation to say, come, check yourself and see, live in a way that is pleasing to God. Christianity includes both the doctrine and the duty. We tend to like the first and hate the latter. Salvation goes with our service. When God has called us, he expects us to live in a way that is pleasing, to conduct ourselves in a way that is pleasing before him. And more so in this context, it's about the unity of the church, the unity of believers. How does that look like? Let's look at this next two verses, verse 2 and 3. And the focus in these two verses is the characteristics of a walk in unity. With all humility and gentleness, with patience, bearing with one another in love, eager to maintain the unity of the Spirit in the bond of peace. These are being presented as the attitude of a Christian that walks in unity. And he lists four of them because this is what he says unity depends on. The opposite, it will be how it is destroyed. Maybe in our culture we may not understand the context of the Gentiles and the Jews having to be one in Christ. The gospel with its mystery being revealed that the Gentiles and the Jews can be one in Jesus Christ, and the gospel have reached to both, and now they are on one footing. They have to share a room because they are one in Christ. You can imagine those who have been called dogs, foreigners, outsiders. Those who have been rejected and now having to be one and share a room. The Gentiles could have their own ego now that they are on the same footing with the Jews. The Jews could still feel like, no, even though we hear of this gospel, but when we see it, we are this side, you are this side. I don't know how you picked your seats even this evening. But if ever, it is because you have looked around and decided that this row is for whites. This row is for English. This one is for Africans. This one is for Indians. And this one is for blacks. This passage is calling us to walk in humility. It's calling us, giving us the picture of humility, the picture we have, that Jesus Christ, being God himself, having to take a form of a servant, having to obey to the point of death, the death of the cross, having to humble himself. The coming of Jesus in a form of man, the Bible calls that humility. He lived that out. He modeled what that looked like. And the Bible is calling us to say, walk in humility. Because humility draws us to the unity of the body of Christ. Because it's the opposite of being ego-driven. What usually causes division in the church is when we look high above everyone else, when we have our own pride. The same attitude we have as a coffee shop we have in the church. Simply because we're paying a service, we demand the service. I don't want the ilovo, I want the salati sugar. I don't want this milk, I want that milk. And I tell you, when you stir my coffee, it's 3 circles to the right and 2 circles to the left. Take it back. And we come to the church. We have the same mentality. It's we feel like we're paying for a service. And we demand the service. It's about us. We think we are here to be served. Because we contribute financially. And we expect people to serve us. People leave the church because the attitude is wrong. People leave the church because I have never been served. I was at the church. I was going through this and no one cared. No one served me. The mentality is that this is a social club. You are here to benefit. And when no one cared for you, then you leave. That's not a Christian mentality. That's not humility. That's pride. You're thinking of yourself. But humility is Christianity, and Christianity will want you to seek to serve and not to be served. And every Christian, if the attitude can be to serve, and everyone will go to be served as everyone will be serving. But if our attitude is that we are here to be served, everyone will sit waiting for someone to serve them, and no one will serving anyone. That will be the problem. That's the problem. It's a walk in humility. Be willing not to have the last word. Be willing not to get your own way all the time. Be willing to seek the common good over your personal preferences. Be willing to put your rights aside in order to do what is right in God's eyes. The other characteristic that builds the unity of the church in the life of a Christian is gentleness. And other translations say meekness. And no one wants to be that way. No one wants to, I'm sure, that attitude of gentleness. No one wants to be looked upon as somebody who's weak. Because we relate meekness as weakness, and people will take advantage of you. And no one wants to put on that attitude and character. But the idea behind the gentleness is not that you are a weak person. Is that you put your strength under control. I've seen my 4-year-old by then, while with the landlords, they're having a big dog. And my 4-year-old was just a stick chasing that big dog away. And the dog was like willing to leave and like happy that, like, you know what, I'm chasing this dog. I look at the picture, I say, like, if that dog stops and turn and fight back, that dog can swallow her alive. But you can understand that I'm the dog being gentle, putting the strength under control, which means, yes, you have power. You have position. But put that under control when you enter to the church. We are associating ourselves. The rich people are one side. Those think they are poor, they are also one side. That's not what we are called to do as a church. The best way to tell if you have that attitude, gentleness, or even humility, ask yourself, how do you react when you are treated like one? How do you react when you are treated like a slave? And that's what we are called to do. The third characteristics we see that build the unity in the church is patience. Verse 2, with all humility and gentleness, with patience. And the word, other translation, I think they will use long-suffering because the word here means to be long-suffering towards people. And that's the attitude we need. That's the characteristics we need to develop to maintain the unity of the church. We need to be those who are patient with one another. Patience doesn't just mean give him the long rope to hang himself. But it's more, I'm giving someone enough time that the Holy Spirit can work in a heart and a life of a person, that they can repent from their sin, that they can mature, that they can be responsible, whatever the case. But give them that enough time as you trust and pray for them. We can't tolerate each other. We don't tolerate each other. And this is the call. Most of the churches, if they could, they will have African service, English service, black or African service, colored service, Indian service, within like a space of 2 hours. So that those who are like-minded can hang around together and don't have to be patient with anyone's idiocy, if there's such a word. Because where we are, we look at someone else and we see the foolishness in the person. Because we don't think in the same way. And we lack that tolerance. But that's not the church that Christ died for. Christ died for the church to be one in him, to bear with one another, to know your brother's weakness, and to help your brother in his weakness as you walk this journey, not to write people off. That's not what we are called for. We are called to be one in Christ. Unity is so important, and that's why it comes as the first thing that the Bible highlights in terms of our walk, our worthy walk. And he said, we're doing that not out of obligation, but with love. With the unconditional love that the Lord has demonstrated to us. We have to do that. Being tolerant is linked to be merciful. Same thing that God is doing with us. We are happy that God is a forgiving God, a merciful God, but we fail to do the same to our brother whom we can see. In verse 3, we see that we have to be eager to maintain the unity of the Spirit in the bond of peace. We have to have that eagerness. We have to be diligent, be committed to make sure that we keep the unity of the Holy Spirit in the church. And I hope this speaks to individuals in the church. Don't think of someone else need to hear this, but think of your own heart. See your own sin where you fall off and repent. Uh, I don't know how to explain this. I'm being eager to maintain this unity. The word doesn't just mean that we just have to think about it, but every effort needs to be made. Every will, reason, physical strength, your total attitude should be in this, endeavoring to keep the unity of peace, making sure you guard against this unity, making sure that you promote unity at all cost. Think about your own family. No one wants a divided family. You're doing everything that there's unity between the spouse, mommy and dad. There's unity between parents and children. There's unity between brothers and sisters. Everyone wants that in a family. Everyone wants that harmony, peace. Everyone wants the family to work together and to love each other. Why can't we have the same eagerness to maintain that kind of unity in God's family? Because in our minds, blood is thicker than water. Our blood family is so important that we will do everything, but the spiritual family, we think less of it. But I must say, even if we could say blood is thicker than water, I will say the church family is more solid than ice. This is the family that Christ died for. This is the family that we should fight for. It is in this family that we should make every effort, our whole being, to see this family functioning together, no matter how diverse we may be. Lastly, why? Because there's a cause. I'll be short in this one. There's a cause. And in verse 4 to 6, there's one body, one spirit, just as you were called to one hope that belonged to your call, one Lord, one faith, one baptism, one God, one Father of all, who is over all and through all and in all, in you all. He's calling us, God is calling us to walk in a manner worthy. In this context, it's about unity as an opening verses. And it shows how that looks like in a believer, the characteristics of a true Christian who's eager to maintain the unity of the Spirit in the bond of peace in the church. And lastly, he's talking about the cause. Why should we commanded to live this way? Why should we care? He's pointing us to the oneness of God. He's pointing us the cause is God. God is not divided. And because of that, he expects the church to be in unity, to be one. The design of God into the church and all that, it has to be based on one concept. By hurting the unity of the church, you are not doing the church any good, but you are supporting and helping the work of Satan. I think it's time to call the church to repent. We are busy thinking of how can we call the nation to repent. But those nations, they come to a divided family. It's time we call the church. It's time to repent. No one of us has been called to be a holy thorn in the church. You are not called to be a holy thorn. You are not called to play the devil's advocate in the church. The unity of the church is so damaged, and the witness of the church is also so damaged because there's no love among the brethren. As I conclude, when a friend of mine asked, "So after this protest, when we get to the church, do we pretend to each other?" I personally believe that Much as it is our constitutional rights to protest in legal protests, and much as the church is separated from the state, and much as we respect the conscience of a believer, much as we know that our mandate ought to be that the church is being united in propagating of the gospel, even though we hold on to different states or political views, much as we know that, I believe that Christians, be it for the protests or be it against the protest, we can do that in a gracious way. One can do in support, the other can do it against. But when we come back as the church, we still need to love and serve each other without pretense. But then if we can't do that, if being for or against, even in a gracious way, if you being for or against, even if it's in a gracious way, but when we come together, we will fail to love and serve each other without pretense, then for the sake of the unity of the church, we will need to refrain from that. But what's so important is that we don't fight as Christians over the political view when we have a mandate to be united in preaching of the gospel. Let our priority come straight. Let's set our priority in order as the church. Chapter 4, verse 3 says we need to make every effort to save the unity that Christ has given us. We are called to walk in a manner worthy, and that's firstly in unity. And we have seen the characteristics of someone who really is showing those attributes of a Christian who endeavoring to make sure that there's a unity in the church. And we have seen that the cause is the one concept of God, and because it's from God, because in God there's no division. Let as a church come to be united in Christ Jesus. Let's bow in prayer. Lord, as individuals, I pray that may you help us to commit ourselves to the oneness that you have designed. Help us to keep the unity of the Spirit and the bond of peace, that we may walk worthy in this world, so that the world may see that indeed we are of you. We pray, Lord, that even though the world may be divided, may the church show the unity in Christ. May we be the model of what that looks like to our neighborhood, to our nation, Lord. We pray that may you work in our hearts to acknowledge our sins, to see where we fall short, and to repent. Help us to be faithful to you for your glory. And in Christ's name we pray, with thanksgiving in our hearts. Amen. I guess please stand with us as we sing the song.